declare thunder. Now, good morning. I want to welcome all of you here, as well as those of you who are joining us on Facebook. If you could all rise for our opening hymn, Every Time I Feel the Spirit.
Mountain.
Holy, holy, holy God, heaven and earth are full of your glory, yet you are here with us this morning. Let us feel your spirit move within us. Let us be moved to pray. Let us be humbled by your mighty blessing as we thirst for your presence in our lives. Let our hymns of praise bring glory to your name. Let our prayers draw us nearer to your will. Let our lives be forever changed by your mercy and grace. Let all the beauty of your kingdom, to you, God, be all the glory, all the honor, and all the praise, now and forever. Amen. And our call to worship is Sweet Hour of Prayer. Now for our special music by Bruce and Joyce Bailey.
In the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, in the morning when I rise, give me Jesus, give me Jesus, give me Jesus. You can have all this world, just give me Jesus.
Thank you, Bruce and Joyce. That was nice. Our announcements. So Ramona's small group, Begin Again, starts this Thursday, March 18th at 6:30 in the Fellowship Hall, following COVID safety guidelines. Ramona's also going to set up a Zoom conference for those who want to stay at home. If you've not gotten your book already, see Joyce Stewart or contact Ramona. This Tuesday, the 16th, is our turn to load backpacks at the middle school. So if you can help with that, we usually show up between 4:15 and 4:30, and that's in the Cuba Middle School through the main entrance there. Well, actually, it's the entrance that goes into the gym is the one we use. And it's not too late to participate in the virtual baby shower for Casey Phoenix. Writer Cash Stephen Phoenix came into the world at 7:51, 3 weeks early. He was 7 pounds, 4 ounces, and 20 inches long. So if you would like to participate in that, they're registered at the Amazon Baby Registry, or you can get the link from Cheryl to participate in that virtual baby shower. And just a reminder that the Ad Council meeting was postponed until next week, Tuesday, March 23rd at 6 p.m. Joys and concerns. Let me start with birthdays. On the 14th is Nick and Alex Laxton. On the 16th is Jacqueline Craig, Jenny Gross, and Ken Holland. And on the 18th is Matt Sherrill. Tim and Karen Timmons are having an anniversary on the 17th. Jim and Jill Barnett on the 18th. And Walter and Heather Ziegler is also on the 18th. Does anyone else have any joys or concerns they'd like to share? Again, let me start. Cheryl's not here to share this one, so I'll share it for her. Congratulations to the Steelville girls basketball team. They took third place in state. So congratulations to those young ladies and their coaches on a great season. I know that's exciting for them. She'd also like to ask for prayers for Trish Callahan and her family in the loss of her brother, Jim Blaylock. Are there any other joys or concerns that you would like to bring forward?
We have a joy. Logan's here today.
Leslie's joy is that their grandson Logan is here today. But it's a concern because he's going home, right?
Well.
I'm sure he's happy he gets to go back to school now, right? No. Logan says no. He's not happy about that. Any other joys or concerns? See none. If you could bow your head in prayer. Father, we are but sinners wandering through this lonesome valley, lost in the sickness of this fallen world. We have not done your will. We have not heard the cries of the needy. We have been selfish and self-serving with your gifts. Yet even as we sin, we feel your Holy Spirit calling us to your lovely bosom. We find solace in knowing we are not alone. Hope in your steadfast love, your will shining as a beacon to guide our path. Every time we feel your Holy Spirit, we are called to pray. We lift the concerns mentioned this morning, as well as those left unspoken, weighing on the hearts and minds of your children to your care. With a grateful heart, we release our concerns, our anxieties, our fears, preventing us from loving with all our heart, mind, soul, and body. In your loving embrace, may we find comfort from your mourning, from our mourning, delight in our suffering, and peace that passes all human understanding. We pray as you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, as we trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Well, good morning, friend.
Good morning.
good to see you here and to see you invisibly over Facebook Live. I'm glad that we are able to be together in this continuing journey, Lent. And as you might recall, we are having as our companion Job, or I guess more technically, the person who wrote Job as he was going through a lot of suffering and pain in his life, that anonymous Hebrew scholar, poet, philosopher, priest, rabbi, whatever you might want to call him. We've been privileged to hear him give us some insights about helping the Bible come alive and insights about the just being able to broaden our view of God. Next week, we're going to conclude our study of Job and hearing his advice for us as we talk about three things we must know about the experience of suffering and our faith. So that will conclude our Lenten journey together before then we will have Palm Sunday in 2 weeks. Just as a refresher, Job, that the setting is that he is unjustly suffering, going through pain that makes no sense to him. His three friends, and I will quotation mark friends, come to comfort him, and then they start tormenting him because they don't like the seeming blasphemies that he's giving, saying this isn't fair. And they start preaching to him the party line, if you will. Well, Job, we have this little verse here in Proverbs that says basically, the Lord rewards those who are righteous and punishes the sinners. Look at you. You're being punished, so you just have to repent. And Job said, as we said last week, it might be in your Bible, but it's not in mine. I cannot believe that based on my experience. Well, today, we're going to hear how Job helps us pray. And some of the things we learn from him might be refreshers for us or might be some new things for us. Regardless, Job really did know how to pray, and hopefully he will help us in our prayer life as well. But first, well, let us pray. Lord our God, thank you for being present. There are all other places you could be, but you are here. Through the music, through our sharing, through the prayers that we've had, through the faces that we've seen, we give you thanks. And now please move your spirit and the words about to be spoken and heard into that which will be thought and felt, so that in all ways we honor your name. Amen. Okay, I'm going to start with audience participation. You feel free to join us in Facebook Live in this too. Complete this prayer. God is great. God is good. Let us thank him for our food. And that is prayed, amen. Thank you. Thank you very much. That is prayed in direct proportion to how hungry you are. And we just put that. We know it, right? But we've done our due diligence to remember God before we jump into the meal. Or how about this one? Now I lay me down to sleep. I pray the Lord my soul to keep. If I should die before I wake, I pray the Lord my soul to take. Amen. Amen. I got to remember that. Isn't that the silliest prayer to say to a kid before bedtime? If I should die, well, I'm sorry, what? But we pray it anyway. It's an act of devotion and hopefully helping the child sleep. How about this one? Hail Mary, full of grace. Well, you went farther than any of us could have. Thank you, because that's a very valued special prayer in the Catholic, with our Catholic brothers and sisters, and they know it. And one person does here, and that's great. It's difficult to pray, but it's very special to them. But we don't know it as Protestants. But I'm going to share with you a prayer from Job that neither Catholics nor Protestants know, for good reason. Here it is. Job has been speaking angrily with one of his, remember, friends, and then he lapses into a prayer. Dear Lord, I'm adding that, dear Lord, I won't keep quiet. I will speak in the adversity of my spirit, groan in the bitterness of my life. Am I a sea or the sea monster that you place me under guard? If I say, my couch will comfort me, my bed will diminish my murmuring. You scare me with visions, frighten me with visions. I would choose strangling and death instead of my bones. I reject life. I don't want to live any longer. Leave me alone, God, for my days are empty. What are your human beings that you exalt them, that you take note of them, visit them each morning, test them every moment? Why not look away from me? Let me alone until I swallow my spit. If I sinned, what did I do to you, guardian of people? Why have you made me your target so that I'm a burden to myself? Why not forgive my sin, overlook my iniquity? Then I would lie down in the dust. You would search hard for me, and I would not exist. Amen. Like I said, Job is the book in the Bible that your mother warned you about. Because this is so in your face, isn't it? You don't pray to God like that. Or do you? We're going to hear that prayer, and we're going to see it within the context of the book, and we're going to be amazed because Job, or that Hebrew writer wrote it, is one who can say, here is how you get closer to God through prayer. The number one thing you would say, if that old Hebrew gentleman were with us today, number one thing he would say is, when you pray, above all else, be honest. Be honest. Don't put on a mask. And so often we put on masks, don't we? Not just with God, but with each other. It's easier, I guess. It's not exactly being dishonest. It's just that this is the way we seem to be. I mean, you know it from your own experience that you could be having the worst day possible. You get criticized by your boss. Your car breaks down. Your daughter brings home her new boyfriend who just got paroled from prison. All of these things. And you run into Bob at the grocery store. Bob asks how you are, and you say, oh, I'm fine. Thank you. How are you? It's called that mask that we wear. And after a while, especially in difficult times, that mask gets awfully heavy, doesn't it? And hasn't it ever been with you that when you're carrying that mask, and maybe for whatever it is you're going through, it sort of builds up, and you're with a friend over coffee, and suddenly, no matter how you try, that mask just drops off. And maybe your eyes well up with tears, and you just say, I don't know what's happening. And the tears come, and your heart unburdens itself. And in the midst of the pain that you feel as that mask comes off, you also feel something else, don't you? Don't you feel a little bit lighter? Don't you feel that strength that simply becomes by affirming your humanness? You're one with the earth and one with all of humanity. That is what Job is doing and experiencing as he prays that prayer that you just heard. The mask has come off and he said, God, I respect you so much. I want to be honest. And here's what I'm feeling. And here's what I'm thinking. Can we ever so do that? That we can be so honest? It does not mean that we're being unfaithful or unholy. It means that we trust God so very much that we can trust God now with our dark side, with our uncertainty. Sure, we can begin a prayer, our Lord, dear Lord, and we can do that, but the biggest thing is be honest and true with who you are. And our friend Job was. And that's about the only prayer I found in the Old Testament that matches it for its starkness. And I have to think that somewhere, when Job prays that prayer, God in the universe says, thank you, at last. I don't know what movie it was about. I don't know whether Morgan Freeman was God or not. One of those movies. Maybe Jim Carrey. I don't know. But it was such that someone had to be God for a day. And in being God for a day, this person was so overwhelmed with all the requests. I want. All the requests. You know, like billions of requests every day. How refreshing it must be for God to hear a few people say, this is what I'm going through. I don't know why you're doing this. Are you being unfaithful? I've ventured out in faith, and this is the reward I get. Gets God's attention there. That's the way Job starts. Who I am, what I'm going through, what I'm feeling, my questions, my doubts. Be honest. And then the second thing we hear from Job about praying is that when you pray this way, the way you ultimately end in prayer will not be the way you begin in prayer. Because when you pray from your heart and you devote your time for this, praying fervently this day and tomorrow, and when you pray that way, you will change. When my son was three and a half, we took him to a party. It was an adult party with some of our friends, but we let him play downstairs. And I was looking at him during this, and my little guy goes and he trips and skins his knee, or does something, bruises his knee. And I see him get up, and he walks across the room, goes up a flight of stairs, turns, goes up another flight of stairs, comes up, sees me, and starts crying. Ow! Boo-boo! So I pick him up, and he goes, Candy make it better. Children, have you ever noticed how children age parents? I'm 37. There he is. But isn't that the way we so often approach prayer? And that's natural, because here we are, frail creatures of dust, and here is God, the omnipotent, the omniscient, the all-powerful. So of course we want to be like, ow, boo-boo, candy make it better in our beginning with God. It's natural, it's okay. But it can never stay that way, because when we pray like Job, we hang in there with God. That's what we do in a relationship. You hang in there with God. You wait for the silent times. You continue listening, and maybe there's a fragment of a hymn, a snippet of a Bible passage, a remembrance. Maybe you're praying as you walk, and you see something you've never seen before in nature, and God speaks to you, and you are changed. That's what happens to Job. He continues being honest with God, honest throughout, and at the very end, it's the most beautiful thing. At the very end, as I mentioned a couple of weeks ago, Job's prayers are answered. Not by everything being nice, but Job's prayers are answered because God comes in a whirlwind and talks to him. And Job's prayer finally ends with his last words, I had heard of you by ear, but now you have cared enough to come and visit me. My mind still has questions, but my heart is full now. And so I relent. And that's when he puts amen to his book-long prayer. Very interesting to note that he has changed at the end to actually seeking what God wants. Because it's as if Job says, thank you for what you've done. How can I serve you? And God says, well, you can pray for your three friends. Because at the end, God goes to those three friends, those very orthodox people who know everything about God. And God says to them, you need to go to Job and ask forgiveness. Ask for a prayer of forgiveness from him, because you have not talked of me what is right, like my servant Job has. Well, those three friends have done the party line. This is what the Bible says, we know. And Job has just been a real person to God. And God says, Job, even praying a prayer like that, has talked of me rightly. And Job does pray for them. Wow. To pray is to be honest with God, a conversation that doesn't necessarily end with the amen on today, but continues. It means to be able to be changed. Prayer changes you. And finally, here's a kicker. Prayer changes God. Alters this heart a little bit. You who are parents, you who are grandparents, great-grandparents, you know that whatever your child is going through, it just as much affects you. You will do everything. You will move heaven and earth to be with that child. You will want to know what that child is going through. You will want to know why that child is going through. You will want to know how can you help that child. You will be up all night. You will do whatever it takes to make it better for that child. If Jesus has taught us anything about God, it's that God is that father of the prodigal son who stays up nights praying for that son, hoping that that wayward child comes home. God in Job is the same one, same dad, if you will. And it's a setup, because that writer, you remember, makes God out at the very beginning to be quite a jerk, quite like Zeus making a bet with the devil. Right? Okay, you do whatever you will to Job, because he won't deny me. He won't curse me. Yeah, it's a setup, because at the end, God is the one who comes to Job, pours out God's heart to Job, and ultimately even does restore Job's health and his wealth and his family. Just as Job is different from how he was at the beginning of the prayer to the end, so is God different because Job dared pray. So remember that. God is not that distant Zeus-like. God is the one who knows the intimacy of your heart. And even Jesus said, go to that closet to pray. God knows the number of hairs on your head. You just pray and be honest. Ultimately, we know God changes, not just because of Job's prayer, but also because of a prayer that one other person, only one other person in the Bible that I know of, ever prayed like Job, and that's in the Bible. Job prayed and saw God in a whirlwind. Jesus Christ on the cross prayed, my God, why have you abandoned me? And God appeared to him and appears to us, not in a whirlwind in the desert, but in an open tomb on Easter morning. Praise be to God. Amen.
Listen to your children pray. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children pray. Send us love, send us power, send us grace. Lord, listen. children praying. Lord, send your spirit in this place. Lord, listen to your children praying. Send us love, send us power, send us grace.
Rise for our statement of faith. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. The third day he rose from the dead, he ascended into heaven, and sitteth at the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. This is the time when we give our tithes and our offerings. As always, there's two plates in the back of the sanctuary. If you would like to leave your offering in there, you may also send it in the mail, drop it by the church office, or give online. Heavenly Father, your word teaches all things work together for the benefit of those who are called according to your purpose. Father, you have called us to give back a portion of that which you so graciously bestowed upon your children. We pray these gifts bring blessings and transformation to those who are in need. In the name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, we pray. Amen. We have our sending hymn, Standing in the Need of Prayer.
It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my brother, nor my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the brother, nor my sister, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher nor the deacon, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not the preacher nor the deacon, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my father nor my mother, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. Not my father nor my mother, but it's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer. It's me, oh Lord, standing in the need of prayer.
What a perfect hymn to end with. For we are all standing in the need of prayer. I think it's appropriate for our benediction, our sending forth today, to do it prayerfully. Because John Wesley had a prayer that sort of sums up how we as Christians are to ultimately be changed by prayer and ultimately what we must ask in prayer. So, let us pray. Lord, I am no longer my own but yours. Put me to what you will, rank me with whom you will. Put me to doing, put me to suffering. Let me be employed by you or laid aside by you, enabled for you or brought low by you. Let me be full, let me be empty. Let me have all things, let me have nothing. I freely and heartily yield all things to your pleasure and disposal. And now, O glorious and blessed God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, you are mine and I am yours, so be it. And the covenant which I have made on earth, let it be ratified in heaven. Amen.
Amen.
Go in peace.